Hey there, welcome to today's video. Today, I'm excited to dive into the world of React with you. Whether you're just starting out or looking to deepen your understanding, this video is for you. We'll explore the core concepts of React that every developer should know and master. These concepts are essential for building the features you see on modern websites, and they're likely what interviewers will expect you to be familiar with. So, let's jump right in and uncover the key ideas behind React. React, in simple terms, is a JavaScript library specifically designed for crafting user interfaces. You know those cool interfaces on websites like Facebook, Netflix, and Airbnb? Yep, many of those are built using React. It gives us developers a bunch of tools and a clear way to organize our work, which speeds up the whole process of building these interfaces. So, with React, making those website designs becomes a whole lot easier and faster. Now, let's talk about single-page applications. You've probably come across them a lot, but just in case you haven't, let me quickly explain. In regular websites, every time you click on a link, the browser fetches a whole new page from the server. It's like flipping through pages in a book. But with single-page applications, it's different. We start with just one page, and whenever you click on something, instead of fetching a new page, we update only the parts of the page that need changing. It's like rearranging furniture in a room instead of moving to a new house every time you want to change. This approach makes things faster and smoother for users because they don't have to wait for new pages to load. And guess what? React fits perfectly into this single-page applications model, making it even easier to create dynamic and responsive web applications. Now, let's dive into components. They're like building blocks for our website's visual design, allowing us to break down our user interface into smaller, reusable parts. Now, how you organize your application is entirely up to you. But typically, we create separate components for each part of our UI and then piece them together into a bigger component, forming the UI for a specific page. So, what exactly is a component? It's essentially a JavaScript function that gives back some HTML code. But wait, there's a little twist here. We actually use something called JSX, which we'll delve into in a moment. And here's a neat thing about components. You can nest them as deeply as you want. Picture it like nesting dolls. A component can hold another component, and that one can hold even more components. It's like building with Lego bricks. You can create intricate structures by combining smaller pieces together. Now, let's take a closer look at JSX. Instead of writing regular HTML tags, we'll be using something called JSX, short for JavaScript XML. It looks a lot like HTML, but with a few tweaks and extra features. For instance, you can use curly braces to insert variables and even add JavaScript directly into your HTML. While JSX tags resemble HTML tags, there are some differences. For example, class declarations are written as class name and event handlers are added differently. Now, here's the thing. Browsers can't understand JSX directly. So before it gets displayed on a web page, it's run through a special compiler that converts it into regular HTML and JavaScript. This way, it can be understood and rendered correctly by the browser. Now, let's shift our focus to React Router. It's what helps us manage multiple pages in a single-page application. With React, we handle URL navigation using a router. This router keeps track of the URL and makes sure that the right components are shown based on it. Since we're not actually loading new pages from the server, the router takes care of updating the components in the browser based on the current URL. It's like a map that guides users through different parts of our app without ever leaving the page. Now, let's delve into the concept of state. State is just a fancy way of saying information that a component keeps track of. We use state to store and manage data within a component. In React, we use something called hooks, like useState to create and manage state. Let's say we have a list of notes we want to display in our app. We can start by setting up an initial state, maybe an empty list. Then we can fetch some data from an API and update our state with that new data. When we update state, it triggers what we call a component lifecycle effect. This is like a signal that tells the component something has changed and it needs to update. We'll dive deeper into that in just a bit. Now, let's talk about props. So, when you want to send data from one component to another, you can do it using props. Think of props like passing a note between friends. Once a component receives a prop, it can use that data wherever it needs to inside that component. And guess what? You can pass props through multiple layers of components if you need to, but sometimes this can get a bit messy. We'll discuss some ways to deal with this shortly. Before we delve into the component lifecycle, I want to share that I've developed 4 complete full-stack React projects on my channel. These projects cover various aspects of React and are great additions to your portfolio. Additionally, if you're looking for another fantastic learning resource, I highly recommend Brilliant, the sponsor of this video. Brilliant offers an interactive approach to learning math, data science, and computer science concepts. They provide diverse lessons in different subjects, organized into courses that you can go through at your own pace. What makes Brilliant stand out is its personalized content, which adjusts to your skill level. Personally, I've found their computer science courses particularly helpful for understanding algorithms and data structures. Their Thinking in Code course is also excellent, teaching coding principles in a practical, real-world manner. Whether you're new to coding or a professional working on complex projects, Brilliant is an invaluable resource for tackling coding challenges. When you sign up, you can take a quick quiz to personalize the content to your interests and proficiency level. Whether you're just starting out or ready to write code for large projects, Brilliant provides support throughout your learning journey. If you're interested, visit brilliant.org/sahand for a 30-day free trial. As a bonus, the first 200 people who use the link in the video description will also receive a 20% discount on the annual premium subscription. A big thanks to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. Now, let's talk about the component lifecycle. Understanding this is super important for any React developer, and it's a common topic in junior developer interviews. So every React component goes through a series of phases in its lifecycle. There are 3 main phases we'll focus on. Firstly, we encounter the mounting phase. This is when the component is first added to the web page. Next comes the updating phase. This happens when the component needs to change something and update accordingly. Finally, we have the unmounting phase. This occurs when the component is removed from the web page. Now, if you're working with functional components, there's a handy tool called UseEffect that lets you work with each of these lifecycle phases. It's like having a guidebook for each stage of a component's life. Now, let's explore React hooks. Hooks are like tools that give functional components superpowers. Before hooks, functional components couldn't hold any state. But with hooks, that all changed. Hooks are basically functions that let us manage state and do other cool stuff. The 2 most common hooks you'll use are useState, which helps us set and update state, and useEffect, which lets us manage the lifecycle of our component. But here's the cool part. React gives us a bunch of built-in hooks to play with, and we can even create our own custom hooks. It's like having a toolbox full of handy gadgets for building awesome components. Now, let's talk about state management. While we can keep track of data within individual components, there are times when we need to share data across multiple components. Imagine you have information about a logged-in user that you need to access in various parts of your app, like the header or a profile section. Passing this data around through props can get messy, especially if it's being updated in different places. So, what do we do? We have a few options. One is using the context API provided by React itself. Another option is using external libraries like Redux, which many developers find helpful. With these tools, we can create what's called global state, data that can be accessed and updated from any component in our app without having to pass it around manually. It's like having a shared storage space where all our components can access the same information. Now, let's talk about the virtual DOM. It's a key concept in React that's worth understanding. Here's the deal. React doesn't directly manipulate the actual web page, the DOM, when it updates components. Instead, it creates something called the virtual DOM, which is like a copy of the real DOM. So, when we make changes to our components, we're actually updating this virtual DOM, not the real one. This might sound extra, but it's actually really smart. React compares the virtual DOM with the real DOM and figures out the most efficient way to update only the parts that have changed, without touching the rest. This makes our apps faster and more efficient because we're not constantly rewriting the whole web page. It's like having a blueprint of your house that you can tweak and refine without tearing down and rebuilding the entire thing every time. Now, let's explore the concept of a key prop. When you're displaying a list of items in your components, there's one important thing you need to remember: the key prop. Each item in your list should have a unique key prop. Think of it like an ID card for each item. Without it, you might run into errors in the console. The key prop helps React keep track of which items have been changed, added, or removed in the list. This way, React knows exactly which parts of the virtual DOM to update, making your app run smoother. It's like giving each item in your list a special marker so React can manage them better. Now, let's see how to use event listeners in React. It's pretty similar to how we handle events in regular JavaScript, but with a few tweaks. In React, we use camel case for event names, and instead of adding event listeners with methods like addEventListener, we simply pass in the function we want to call directly within curly braces in our JSX code. This means our JavaScript code and HTML are kind of mixed together, which might seem a bit strange at first, but it actually makes things more streamlined. It's like having everything you need right at your fingertips, without the extra steps of traditional event handling. Next, let's explore handling forms in React. It's a bit different from the traditional way because we try to keep all our form data stored in the component's state. Normally, HTML elements like input fields, text areas, and dropdowns manage their own state and update as users type or select options. But in React, we take a different approach. We attach event listeners to each field and update the component's state whenever the user makes a change. So instead of relying on the form to handle everything, we use methods like onChange and onSubmit to directly update our state. It's like taking more control over how our form behaves, making it easier to manage and customize. Now, let's talk about conditional rendering in React. Sometimes you'll need to show or hide content based on certain conditions in your app. For example, think about displaying a user's name in a navigation bar. If the user is logged in, you want to show their name. If they're not logged in, you might not want to show anything. One way to handle this is by using the logical AND operator. Another option is to use the inline if-else conditional operator, which allows you to add extra logic if needed. In both cases, what gets rendered depends on the conditions you set. It's like having a switch that turns content on or off based on what's happening in your app. Now, let's talk about some common commands you'll use in every React project. These are like your go-to tools for getting things up and running. First up, we've got the npx create React app or npm create vite commands. These ones are super handy because they set up all the basic files you need for a new React application. Next, there's the start command. This kicks off your development server so you can see your project in action right away. And finally, we have the run build command. This one's important for when you're ready to deploy your app. It builds a directory containing all your production ready files. So, these three commands are like your trusty sidekicks, helping you build and deploy your React app smoothly. All right. That wraps up the core concepts every React developer should know. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.